Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It's great to have you with us. If you've not been to the Defence Force Academy before, well, welcome to the campus, and I welcome on behalf of UNSW Canberra. Most people say, UNSW Canberra, where's that? And well, it's only been here since 1986. And people do confuse us with Duntroon, which we are not. We're actually the university. And it's been the University of New South Wales's privilege to be in a partnership with Defence for the education of uniformed people, but also civilians here in Canberra for many, many years. The initial agreement between Defence and the university was signed 49 years ago last week. So that tells you that something important will happen here a week ago next year. There we are. The reason for us being here is that today is the centenary of when Charles Bean had a vision for what became the Australian War Memorial. It was during a battle in which, perhaps at a point of time where he tried to make sense out of something that was very difficult for anyone to make sense of, the idea of a war memorial, some way of capturing the spirit, but also the experience of those who served in Fromelles and Pozieres, this was the moment somehow that it came to him. And of course, that vision did lead to the Australian War Memorial and did lead to the Great War history, of which he was the general editor. And it led him, after the war, to reflect upon what he had seen and what he had experienced. And for reasons that aren't altogether clear, and we don't know what particularly prompted him to write, he wrote a poem called Non Nobis. And if I can just read the words to you as best I can, because tonight we are much favoured to have a premiere performance, not once or twice, of this poem set to music. I'll come to that in a moment. But let me read to you Non Nobis. Not unto us, O Lord, to tell thy purpose in the blast, when these that towered beyond us fell and we were overpast. We cannot guess how goodness springs from the black tempest breath, nor scan the birth of gentle things in these red births of death. When he wrote this, it was a very discordant note in the 1920s, when people were still, in one sense, trying to hold on to a patriotic vision of what occurred in the war, and perhaps weren't in a position or were unable to get a sense of the human tragedy that the war was, the terrifying sounds and sights and smells of being in the Western Front in really what turned out to be the most terrible cataclysm of modern humankind to that point. When we were preparing for this conference, and we're in the middle of the conference today, we looked at Charles Bean, the man, his legend, and tomorrow we're looking at the official history tradition that he founded. It was my friend Peter Stanley who mentioned to me Non Nobis, and that what we might do is commission a piece or pieces of music that could be, if you like, a vehicle whereby Bean's name and this particular poem, which itself requires a fair bit of, I think, explanation, if not interpretation. I think in one sense you can almost make of it what you will and what you might. We thought this would be a way, perhaps, of getting into the popular mind and the popular consciousness some Australian music and some Australian words. Last year we held a conference here looking at Anzac Day past and present. And for those who don't know me, I was the Anglican bishop to the Defence Force in the early part of the previous decade. And I decided to write the chapter on music. And I said that it was pretty bad. Pretty bad from the point of view that we didn't have Australian compositions, either words or music. And yet this was a day which was so evocative in our national life. And so it was our hope, Peter and I, that by raising the profile of these words and setting them to music, it might just be possible. It might just be possible when what we're about to hear appears on YouTube that Australians might decide this is a good thing that we might do, that we might have an Australian composition with words by Charles Bean so that his memory lives on, but also that we've made our own mark on this day and on its remembrance. So we have two premier pieces this evening. The first and to the same set of words. The music has been composed by Ian Munro, who I'll speak to in a few moments' time, but we're much favoured this evening by having the Burgundian singers from the University of New South Wales, and they are conducted this evening by Sonia Maddox, who is the Director of Music, Art and Culture at UNSW. Sonia, thank you for bringing your people to us this evening. Can I just ask, when you got presented with these words and this music, what did you make of it?
Well, we were presented with it as words and music, not as words and then music. So, from the beginning, it's set as a funeral march, and we worked through it as a piece of music initially, and it took a little while for, I think, the text to sink in with the group of singers. But as that happened, it changed in flavour a lot, a great detail. The other thing is that what you'll hear is a piece of Latin text throughout, Non Nobis Domine. We actually sang this as a chant in our concert last year as a round, and you'll hear it today in a different form and set throughout the text by Charles Bean as well.
And Sonny, can you just tell us briefly, who have you brought here with you this evening?
I brought the Burgundian Consort. This is the chamber choir of UNSW. We have a large choir of between 80 and 100 singers called the Collegium Musicum. But these singers are what we call the elite group. We sing mostly unaccompanied repertoire.
Who calls them the elite group?
I do. But and we've got singers from right across the campus. So we have alumni, we have postgraduate students, we've got students of law and psychology and science and all sorts of things aside from music students, because of course music goes right across the campus, it's not just in one single school. So that's who we have, ranging from first year right through to more senior members.
Who's the first year?
We let her come. But we do have one. Yes.
And who's playing the piano for us?
And we have Harrison, who is one of our graduates. He did a Bachelor of Music and Bachelor of Advanced Science in Physics, as you do, and he's going on to become a conductor now, doing postgraduate study.
So he did a degree in Physics and Music.
Yes.
Now there's a person I need to have a conversation with. Would you please welcome them this evening?
Thank you.
Ian Munro.
That's
me. Hello. You can tell I've always wanted to have my own talk show. Ian, what's it like the first time someone performs publicly a piece that you've composed? Is it kind of like for an author it's a book launch? Is it something like that?
I don't know. I haven't had a book launched, but it's nerve-wracking. I find it, I don't know, even now, I don't know how many times it's been, but I get nervous every time. It's the unexpected. You know, you think you know how something's going to sound, and it might or might not sound that way. But the big thing is you don't know how it's going to come over. You know, for me, the greatest joy of writing music is when other people enjoy it. Basically, that's it. So I hope people enjoy it. And if I don't think they do, then I don't enjoy it either.
Do people actually tell you?
You'd be surprised. Yes, they do.
I would be surprised.
No, they do.
I enjoyed it.
Well, that's one. No, I have particularly friends of my mum, they who aren't particularly, you know, music lovers, who've started to come to music late in life. They're great because they tell you things that other people don't, and you need to hear. I mean, you actually do need to hear what people think, and sometimes people are way too polite to tell you. So that's where I get my information from.
Now, you were born in Melbourne, attended Scotch College. You obviously had an early aptitude for music, and while you were studying at the Victorian College of the Arts, you won the ABC Instrumental and Vocal Competition in 1982, and that, I presume, confirmed you in the view that you were heading in the right direction in your life's work?
Look, those sorts of things are great steps along the way, and yes, they help. They introduce you to the profession and give you a start.
And what led you to think, though, that you could compose music of your own?
Well, Tom, it's a long story, but I won't tell the long story. In the 1980s, it was quite difficult for people like me who love melody and harmony and who love the tradition and wanted to be part of the tradition, because back in those days, modernism was held sway and sort of ultra modernism. I don't know whether anybody here went to concerts in those days and heard some pretty freaky sort of music. And it was at a point where I think audiences were most suspicious of new music. Most players didn't particularly enjoy it. It was very cliquey. So new composition wasn't really something that most people felt that they would ever enjoy. It's changed now, but that was the environment in which I started writing music. And like a few of my friends of my age, we were very much put off. So I went off and played the piano for 20 years and didn't write much and then came back to it. And it's not an uncommon story, actually. So it's a much healthier situation now. Where people like me can write, you know, tonal music that critics might call very, very old-fashioned. But I don't care. I think the traditions of music are way greater than any one stylistic moment in time. And the great thing about today is that we can appropriate all sorts of different styles in which to write, where they're appropriate. So that's what I do in my music these days.
So when we sent Non Nobis to you, what did you make of it? And what's the creative process for you? Did you think, oh, well, I could do this as a 2-minute piece, a 4-minute piece, a 6-minute piece? How do you creep up on a task like this?
The task of writing, well, first of all, I'd say that you hinted at it before, that music that has to do with anything patriotic is already wading way into a minefield. I think that patriotism and music are very uncomfortable bedfellows, if you put it that way. But patriotism doesn't usually work in music unless it's done exceedingly well, because it can be drum thumping. But with this poem, I sensed that there was something very sincere about it. Austere also helps, because it's not invested with sort of cloying personal feelings, but it seems to be his attempt to penetrate something a bit way beyond that and more timeless. So that helps in writing music, because one can also take a bit more of an objective musical view of things. I liked the fact that it had that Latin reference in it. I mean, the Non Nobis canon was reputedly something that the Knights Templar said, or perhaps even sang, as they marched off to the Crusades. I don't know whether Bean was being, I don't know why he exactly he was alluding to that, or whether he was doing it intentionally. I presume he was, because he was a very learned man. So that also helped, because it pointed backwards to not just to, you know, a very famous earlier period of war, but also was sort of a nod to the eternal idea of war again, which helps because it means that as a musician I can reference earlier periods, which I did. All of those things go into the mix, and for a composer, it's always a starting point. The starting point is the difficulty. Once one has a starting point, a starting musical idea, then one can pull the strands towards you and explore where that might lead. So Bean already gave that important musical starting point.
Now, you've mentioned patriotism, and the piece you're going to play for us now was composed by Claude Debussy, who was exactly the same age as you are now.
That's right.
When he composed this piece. I read that when the war began, he almost retreated into himself.
Yes.
He was so shocked, depressed by the dark abyss into which humanity had fallen, and he felt that he couldn't write anything, but he did bring himself to compose the Berceuse Héroïque for piano, dedicated to His Majesty King Albert I of Belgium and his soldiers. You're going to play that for us now. What drew you to this particular piece?
Well, first of all, I mean, Debussy is one of the two great 20th century French composers, the other one being Maurice Ravel, who is 13 years his junior. Debussy, I still think, is one of the great 20th century composers, even though he died in 1918. And by the time he was writing this, he was already becoming ill, and yes, he was depressed, like a lot of Parisians, like a lot of French. The war had just begun, the Germans had invaded Belgium, and the Belgian refugees were crossing over into France, and the French were viewed them as their brothers and sisters. And Debussy was very reluctant, although he wanted to write music at this point. As you say, he was too depressed to write very much. But this is the first thing he wrote in November 1914. He was also reluctant to venture into patriotism because he avoided, as he put it, he avoided in his music blatant emotion. He avoided blatant things. He liked to indicate things subtly. And the way he did it in this piece, I think, is quite fascinating and very, very moving, is that he deliberately quotes the Brabançon, which is the Belgian national anthem, but he does this in quite an oblique way. So anyone who knows the anthem will hear it, will pick up on it. But he would never just put it in, you know. He would never just stop what he was doing and sing the Brabançon. So this is what he does in his entire output. But here, in doing it this way, he manages to honour the Belgians, whom he greatly admires. He manages not to glorify war. He manages not to write a funeral march. It's very much more mature than that. Quite beautiful, I find very moving, and it expresses all of Debussy's feelings about what might be coming. And remember, he didn't actually live to the end of the First World War. He witnessed all of the awful things without coming out the other end, which I think is quite sad.
We look forward to hearing it. Thanks, Ian. Thank you. music, it seems to me, is like history, open to lots of different interpretations. And the Gabriel singers from the Canberra Girls Grammar School have also had commissioned for them a piece making use of Non Nobis, produced, rather composed by Dan Walker. Would you please welcome the Gabriel singers? So this is our second never before performed in public piece. Girls, don't be nervous. They're conducted this evening by Rowan Martin. Rowan, welcome. What was it like to rehearse with the girls of this particular piece of music with these particular words?
Well, to be honest, the girls, both the girls and I, didn't know this work, didn't know the piece, didn't know the poem before we got this piece. And last year, our then head of music had contacted you to be part of this, and so she contacted Dan Walker down in Melbourne to write this piece. And he's come up with a piece that is very evocative, I think, of the words, and it's got a very brooding, sort of ever-shifting piano accompaniment that sort of adds to the quite dark nature, I think, of the words, and it tends to capture the struggle, I think, that Bean was having with his faith and things at that time. It seems to, that's what it seems like to me. For the girls, I think yesterday...
Girls, was it difficult? You can respond at this point.
I don't think it was... What do you think?
It's challenging.
Challenging? A little bit, yeah.
They had a lovely time with it. It's very, very well written for them. They have a very, it's both challenging but very tuneful, very has lots of dissonances and changes in colour. And I think they've had a lovely time with it. It makes a beautiful sounds, so it suits their voices very well. I don't think it's been particularly. It's not difficult. It's easy to sing and it's lovely to listen to. So it's not, again, what Ian was talking about with contemporary music. It's contemporary music that I think is very accessible. But it still says something. And I think music doesn't have to be out there in order to say something. So, and I think that's what this piece is doing.
And tell us something quickly about the singers. Who are they? Where do they come from?
This is our top girls choir at Canberra Girls Grammar. They are, it's an audition choir and all the girls must have singing lessons in order to be in this choir. They are very serious about this choir and enjoy singing in it, and competitive to get into. So it's the very, as they were saying about the Burgundian choirs, it's the elite group, I think, of girls, and they are very, very committed to performing very well and representing their school.
Thank you. And playing the piano for us tonight is?
The lovely Kylie Loveland, who is wonderful, who's at every rehearsal, and she's our wonderful accompanist who accompanies all our groups.
And Natalie Gill is here as well.
Yeah, Natalie Gill, our acting head of music, yes.
And can I also say in advance thank you for those parents who've come to be with us tonight. We'll make sure you get a copy of the video for grandparents as well. I say this as a grandparent. There we are. Thank you. We look forward to what you've got to share with us.
Hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
Girls, on behalf of us all, many thanks for your music. Our thanks to Dan Walker for his composition. I'm sure that 90 years after Charles Bean composed these words, he would never have imagined that they would be used in this way, enhanced in this way, and we're grateful to you for your music and for your commitment to us this evening. So again, let's thank them for being here.